Other way, will you? All right, man, coolest pastor appreciation gift ever. All right, let's pull out the word of the Spirit here. The sword of the Spirit, excuse me. I want to read to you a verse from the Gospel according to John. Jesus is speaking. This is John 15. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, which means you guys are coming back, right? You're not just leaving now that I'm doing the sermon. All right. So if Jesus is speaking to his disciples, that means he's speaking right to us. So listen now to the word of God beginning in verse 4 of John 15. Jesus says, "Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing." Amen. All right, for a lot of us, there is a real gap in our spiritual lives. You know, we believe in God, we believe in Jesus, we've made a profession of faith, we've committed ourselves to Jesus, but we haven't seen that spiritual transformation that is promised. I mean, Jesus says that we will bear much fruit. And that's sort of Bible language for there should be some practical results for our life and our relationship with God. And that practical fruit, that practical results is described in different ways. But here's one thing, or a list of things that should be produced in us. It's from Galatians 5:22, where it says, "The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." And we look at that list and we think to ourselves, where is that in my life? Right? I believe in you, God. Why is my life filled with anger and worry and anxiety and shame and selfishness and a lack of self-control? That there is a gap between what I profess to believe and the practical, tangible results of that belief in my life. And what I want you to do is I want you to look a little bit more closely at this passage from John, because he doesn't just say, "Believe in me." What does he say? "Abide in me." Abide in me as a branch abides with a vine. Abide in me, I will abide in you, and then the fruit will come. And so what I'd like to do today and for the next three Sundays after today is do this little sermon series on the idea of abiding in Christ. Today I'd like to just kind of start off with the basics and ask the question, well, what does that even mean, to abide in him? I mean, abide's kind of an old word. I think I asked some of you guys last week, did you even know what the word abide means? And a lot of you didn't. What does it mean? Abide in me, what's he asking you to do? Yeah, to abide means to live with, to dwell with, to remain with. I used a little bit of an older translation than I normally used, the New RSV. The newer translations, they don't use the word abide. I think it's because it's an old-fashioned word. And the New Living Translation translates it remain. Remain in me as I remain in you, and you will produce, there will be much fruit. But you know, I didn't use that because, I don't know, remain just doesn't seem to get to the depth of what he's talking about here. Remain just doesn't quite, you know, I mean, he's describing the relationship of a vine and a branch that are connected and share life together. And, you know, about the best example that I can think of is marriage. You know, in a marriage, you shouldn't just remain together, right? I mean, remaining together just kind of sounds like you're just kind of sharing some space. Hopefully, Allie, my wife and I, we do more than just remain together. That as we dwell with each other, that our lives become interconnected and her life flows into me and my life flows into her. You know, we talk about things, we talk about important things, and the way we think begins to, you know, she's changed the way I think about a lot of things. Unfortunately, I've changed the way that she thinks about some things. We share all of our problems. We share in trying to solve those problems. Our moods affect each other. When she's happy, I tend to be happier. And when she's upset, well, often I get a little upset too, right? We affect each other's moods. That there's this intertwining of life together that comes when you abide together. And that's what we're being offered. When Jesus says, abide in me as I abide in you, he's talking about that intertwining and sharing of life. That's what Paul is saying when he writes to the Colossians. And he says, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the reality of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all of his glory. Now, as you look at verse 2 in that little passage, and it says, think about the realities of heaven, not the realities of earth. I don't think that he's primarily telling us to walk around picturing a golden city with a pearly gate. I don't think that's really what he means by the realities of heaven. What I think he wants us to focus on is the fact that all of us are surrounded by all of these earthly problems and situations and anxieties and all of these things, this everyday life. And Paul is saying, that's not what defines you. What defines you is your relationship with the King of Heaven. What defines you is the fact that you abide in him, even though that's to a degree hidden from other people, that you abide in him and he abides in you, that you have this shared life. Think about that shared life as you go through life. Think about the realities that the King of Heaven is with you at all times, that you abide in him. And we still say, well, I don't get what you mean by abide in him. How does our life intertwine with Jesus so that our lives are changed? And remember, this is all, eventually there should be some practical results. Some love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So what does it mean to abide with him? So I'll look back at the passage. It doesn't say abide with him. What does it say? Abide in him. And we say, that's even weirder, right? How do you abide in someone? And that idea of being in Christ is actually something that's repeated over and over in the New Testament. For instance, Philippians. Got the Philippians passage? Paul writes, he says, I'm writing to all of God's holy people in Christ Jesus. Those of you who are in Christ. Or in 2 Corinthians, he says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. In Ephesians, he writes, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of the truth of the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in Christ with a seal, the promise of the Holy Spirit. That line, that phrase, being in Christ, is repeated 160 times in the New Testament. That's a lot. And it's not language that's familiar to us. We don't talk that way. We don't say, those of you who are in Christ, are you in Christ? I'm in Christ. We don't even know what that means. I mean, if it's repeated 160 times, we should get it. So how are you in someone? Well, one of the best known stories in the Old Testament is the story of David and Goliath. And if I ask you to raise your hands, of those of you who know the story of David and Goliath, I'm guessing that pretty much everybody's going to raise their hand. There you go. Because even if you don't read the Bible very much, you know that this story of David and Goliath is about a really big guy named Goliath and a really small guy named David, and they fight in this single combat. Now, what you need to understand is it wasn't just a single combat, that they were the champions of their two respective peoples, that they met on a battlefield because the two armies of the Philistines and the Israelites were each on a hill, and there was a little shallow valley in the middle, and they didn't really want to run in there and get killed. And so they said, we will just have one person go and represent all of us. All of us are in this one person. He represents all of us. And so what happens to this one person happens to us. And that's why after, you know, spoiler alert, David kills Goliath. It's not just Goliath that's defeated. And it's not just David who's victorious. All of the hopes and dreams of those two people are in those two persons. And so when Goliath is defeated, all of Israel cheers and all of the Philistines run away because in him they were all defeated. To be in someone is to be connected in your identity and to be connected in your destiny with that person. Now, everybody who's a sports fan should be able to grasp that a little bit. Because as I walk around these days, I see a lot of people wearing Astros gear, right? A lot of people wearing orange. Some of them even wear the jerseys with the, and when we watched the game last night, those of us who were fans, at the end we said, we won! Well, you didn't pitch, you didn't hit, you weren't sitting in the dugout, but those few people represent all 6 million people in the area of Houston. We are all in them so that our identity is so locked into their identity that when they win, we win, right? And so, you know, you'll see somebody walking down the street with a shirt. On the back of the shirt, it might say Altuve. Okay, little heads up. Don't walk up to them and say, Mr. Altuve, you did very well, right? They've taken on his identity. He represents them on the baseball field. That our identity is locked in, and our destiny will be, those of us who are fans, will be rooting tonight, and we will either be elated or we will be heartbroken. Our destiny, our future is tied together with that team. So that's one example of how we are in somebody else. Identity, destiny. But you know what? You're not a sports fan. You're like, I don't really get that. I don't really understand how you people identify with them. Well, it happens in other areas of life too. Politics is one of those areas, right? If you identify with one of the parties, right? When your party's candidate wins, you say, we won! You're not going to govern anything, okay? You are not the president. You are not the Congress. You are not the mayor. But you know what? Your identity is such that you can say, we won, and you feel like your destiny is tied to the fact that they won. And it kind of is, right? Another example of being in someone, again, is probably marriage. When you get married, your identities begin to overlap. You even take the same last name. And your destinies are tied together. Your victories are their victories. Sometimes couples forget that, right? But it's true, right? That your victories, your defeats are all tied together. If I lose my job, Allie loses too. So the idea of being in someone is all about getting your identity and your destiny tied together with theirs. And that's exactly what the Bible means when it says that now we are in Christ. For instance, I can't remember where it is. You got it. There you go. Galatians. Yeah. He says, this is Paul writing. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. Okay, Paul was never crucified. What he's saying there is that his identity and his destiny now have been tied to Jesus so much that it's as if he too has been crucified. The reality of it is that for all of us who have placed our faith in Jesus Christ, it's like we were crucified. That's why we talk about him paying the debt for our sin. The penalty for sin is death. And it's as if we died on the cross with him. I have been crucified with Christ. And it's now no longer I who live, Paul says, but Christ lives in me. I am in him and he is in me. Now the life I live in this body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved and gave himself for me. My identity is now tied to him. And because my identity is tied to him, my destiny is tied to him. Which is why Paul says this. It says, if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will also certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Jesus was raised from the dead, and because we are in Christ, we too will share in that resurrection, and we too will be raised from the dead. Another passage that says the same thing, Romans 8, for God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that the son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Look, the point there is that the identity of Jesus is that he is the Son of God. That he calls God Abba Father. And because we are in Christ, now we too have been included into the family of God. And we too are sons and daughters of God. And now we too can say to this God who created the universe, you are my Father, Abba. He has shared his identity with us. And the passage in Romans 8 goes on to say that now, having chosen them, he called them to come to him, and having called them, he gave them right standing with himself. Having given them right standing, he gave them glory. In other words, all the things that Jesus has, he shares with us because we are in him. We share in that standing, being able to stand. None of us is righteous. We screw up. But Jesus has shared his identity as the righteous one with us so that now we are in right standing with God. And now we will share in all of the glorious things that the Father gives to his Son. That we will rule and reign with him, not because of who we are, but because our identity now is found in him. All these things are what it means to be in Christ. We share an identity and we share a destiny. And I would love at least one little amen that we would be just as happy about that as we are about being in the Astros and maybe the Astros coming back and winning some stuff. Right? Amen. All right, there you go. You know, I've seen the Facebook meme where it says, you know, you should be happier about Jesus than you are about this winning the Super Bowl, so you should dump Gatorade on the pastor at his next sermon or something like that. Don't do that. Don't really. I will not feel appreciated if you do that. I know. Take the mic off. Don't electrocute me. Yes, that'd be good too. Okay. So when Jesus says, abide in me, he's saying, come and get your destiny and your identity. So how do you begin to be in Christ? How do you enter into Christ? Oh, this is not rocket science. You know the answer to this. How do you enter into this new status and this new destiny? Yes, you have to make a commitment, right? What does it say in that Ephesians passage that we read a minute ago? It says, you also were included. In other words, you got pulled in. The vine pulled you as a branch into, the metaphor doesn't quite work, but you understand what it's saying there, right? When you heard the message of truth, the gospel of salvation, when you believed, you were marked in him. Now, belief in the Bible means more than just belief about something. It's not like, well, I believe in the existence of God or I believe in the existence of Jesus. Belief in the Bible always means a commitment. I believe in you in the sense of I am going to follow you. I am committing myself to you. And, you know, you get that and being in, you know, any of the other things that we talked about, they all involve commitments, right? Even being a fan, you have to kind of commit yourself to being a fan. You know, you commit yourself to a political party, and you certainly commit yourself to your spouse. And when you commit yourself, only then. So the idea, when he invites us to abide in him, it's an invitation to a commitment. And I love what he says there, because he not only says that we will abide in him, what else does he say? He will abide in us. Now how... We've talked about how we get our identity and our destiny from him. We abide in him. We get included into his family, into all those things. How does he abide in us? Now, you should know the answer to this one, too. It's an easy one. How does he abide in us? Yeah, that's right. And again, that Ephesians passage tells us. He says, when you were included in Christ, when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, when you believed, you were marked in him. And the seal, meaning the stamp, was that he gave you his Holy Spirit. The very Spirit of Jesus himself is given to those who make that commitment. The very Spirit of Jesus begins, and you think about that, fits in with that image of the branches and the vine, because the life flows, the sap flows from the vine into the branches, and the Holy Spirit is the life of God flowing into us. It's as Jesus abides in us through his Spirit, and the Spirit begins to make those transformations and produce in us the love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. And that's how it works. And you say, that's really great, but we're back where we started. Because I do believe, I have made a commitment, and I'm not getting the sap here. I'm not seeing the fruit. I'm not peaceful. I'm full of anxiety. I'm not patient, and I'm getting really impatient for my patience, right? And we say, why is there a gap between what I believe and what I experience? And remember, I have been comparing this the whole sermon, the whole idea of abiding in Christ. I've been comparing it to a marriage. It begins with a commitment. You know, your wedding day, you stand in front of everybody and you make a commitment. I am committed to you. This is my person, right? Well, are you going to feel all the effects of abiding with that person on the first day? It takes time. It's a process of living and being with that person, of listening to them and caring for each other. It's a process by which your lives get intertwined. And so, you know, maybe it's just, you know, you just need, it just takes some more time of abiding with him before all of the fruits are there. And you just keep talking to him and you keep asking him and you keep praying that he's going to produce these things in you, and he will. But here's another thing. Not every marriage is a good one. I won't ask for any amens there. Not every marriage is a marriage in which the two people abide together, in which there is that intimacy. Some marriages, it's just about sharing space. And so the question that we have to think about, if there is a gap, is, do I treat the Spirit of Jesus the way a neglectful person treats their spouse? Do I ignore the Spirit until I need something? do I make time to spend with him, or am I just too busy? Do I listen and value what he says, or do I just dismiss it? Do I do the things that are important to him, or do I put them off? If you have a marriage like that, then there's probably some intimacy missing. If you have a spiritual walk like that, there's probably some fruit that's missing. So what we're going to do over the next 3 weeks is we are going to talk about abiding with him and doing it in some practical ways so that we can begin to grow in our intimacy with him, that his spirit will flow more freely through us, and that we can begin to experience more of that love and joy and peace and patience that will be produced in our lives. So I hope you will come back, because even if things are a little dry right now, there is hope, because he's promised these things. And you know what? God never breaks his promises. Amen. So I hope to see you next week. Lord, we thank you that you don't just leave us alone to muddle by, to get through life as best we can, that you offer to share life with us, that you offer to share everything with us, an identity, a destiny, that you share your death with us so that we can say, along with Paul, I have been crucified with Christ. The debt for my sin has been paid. And we can say that we stand as forgiven. We stand in right relationship. We stand as your children, sharing in the identity of our elder brother Jesus. And that we can look forward to a destiny, a glorious destiny of resurrection and life and ruling and reigning with you. And so, Lord, help us to focus on these things, to keep our minds on the things of heaven and not the things of earth. And Lord, begin to pay more attention and more care and more focus on our relationship with you. And Lord, we struggle to do that. And maybe some of us feel guilty that we haven't done it. And let us know that you're a God who is quick to forgive, a God of loving kindness, a God who is always ready to forgive, a God who's always looking towards the future and not to the past. So Lord, we thank you and we call you Abba Father, and we pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.